European eels have unbelievable life cycle, which was a mystery for thousands of years. They're born in Sargasso Sea near North America and then travel up to 6,000 kilometers to Europe, where they enter fresh water, spend there about 15 years and then migrate all the way back to give birth. But since 1970s, their population in Northern Sea declined by 99%, making them critically endangered due to hydroelectric dams and barriers, overfishing, parasites, and much more. That's why we're on our way to Netherlands to meet arriving eels and help to save them.
And it's hard to believe that after such huge journey, they end up here.
Well, it's not the most scenic place, but they're a much bigger problem right now.
So we came here to do a monitoring evening, as usual. Pumping station here, it's pumping water right now into the sea. The problem with that is that for glass eels, this stream is much too strong. I mean, if you imagine the glass eel, it's 6 to 10 centimeters. It's completely see-through, tiny. Yeah, it's just not strong enough to be able to pass through this water stream.
About 27% of Netherlands is below sea level, which is why they have developed extensive water management systems, dikes, pumping stations and canals to protect against flooding. But at the same time, they created a problem for migrating species.
So the net is down there, we're fishing right now for eels, but it was a bit rainy and now a lot of fresh water accumulates there in the canals and they put all of the water out, which makes it very difficult for eels to get through. So today we don't have much expectations to see any eels, maybe just a few, but still it's part of research and the job has to be done.
3, 2, 1. Yo!
We have an eel.
Yeah, we have.
Here. Just one. I'll put him in the water.
Perfect. Nice.
Oops. All the eels we catch, we put them here in the aquarium. Because when you put them back, you can catch them again.
Yeah.
So one eel you can count for 5 times.
So we continued with our research and by the end we catch 3 eels, some shrimps and other small fish. All of them were released back after counting.
This is what we have on a good day. It's because we don't have connected water and the water spilled away. So yeah.
So it's good, we got 3.
I'm happy.
The aim of this night research was to see how many eels are trying to enter the fresh water. And even if we wouldn't catch anything, it would still be an important data. But next morning we're setting up a laboratory, because now we want to see how many eels successfully made it and passed to the fresh water.
Should be everything, but there's a lot in that other one as well.
Gloves and paper and lamps and tissues and needles.
Oh wow!
For tagging. Different location, get different colors, and so we can see what day the glass eel is tagged and how long it takes to get into the fish passage and through it.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it takes a lot of people, a lot of volunteers, and a lot of stuff to do this work.
It's good.
Quite a big operation, yeah.
So we're gonna tag eels and put them into this water.
Here's the pump and here's installed passageway for a fish to pass safely from sea to the canal. But we need to understand how effective it is and if it really works. We left a fike at the end of the passageway. So every fish which successfully passed it should be in our net right now. Then we will count and tag them and release back into the fresh water.
this is some substrate for them to take shelter.
Grab.
Ooh.
So now they fall through the net.
Yeah.
So there's not that much eel, but there's also not a lot of other fish. So we would expect to see more gobies. We have a lot of gobies usually, and now I think it's only one or two. It is what it is.
Yeah.
It's not a lot, but we take what we can get, right?
Yeah. I'm not sure what we're gonna do with the crab, but we got some glass eels. And now we're gonna tag them, but also count how many successfully passed from this side, from the seaside, to the fresh water. We need at least 37. If there are less, we cannot tag them.
It does have impact on these individual fish that are tagged, so we don't want to do that in vain. Like, if we don't reach our minimum numbers, we can't do the science or the data on it. If we think we can't answer our research questions, then we shouldn't harm these animals.
Which means if we don't have at least 38 eels now, we won't have a research
28,
today.
29.
It's on
the 30. Yeah.
We need just two more.
I'm gonna count them again.
Count them again, maybe.
Yeah.
We are really good at building sluices and dikes and everything, so it's quite hard for European eel to get into the fresh water. So that's the big one. The chemical PFAS and other chemicals, the barriers, the water quality, and also the fishery. Yeah, different reasons why it goes not really good with the... Actually, it goes really bad with the species, yeah. So we have to protect it, yeah.
After counting second time, we got even one less. So now it's only 34.
You know, this is disappointing. This means the passage is it's not working very well. Because this spike has been there for since Saturday.
Yeah, 5 days?
Yeah.
And that's what we got in 5 days?
Yeah. Well, a good number would be thousands, probably. Mm. So this right here is showing that the passageway is poorly functioning. Yeah, yeah. We have the numbers on the outside. Somehow it's not making sense for the fish to go through. And that's what we're gonna investigate this week to see if there's any bottleneck problems that we can look at and say, oh, this we can fix and make it easier for not only eel, but all the other fish as well to pass through. Yeah.
Because they're really endangered. Like if you look at the data from 1990 till now, you see that like the glasses that get in from the Sargasso Sea, it's around like 1.5% in the whole North Sea area. So that's quite rough.
We're gonna wait until tomorrow and see if we have a bigger number, and then tag them all together.
In the Netherlands, we have a lot of water which is suited for the eel, but about 40% of it they just cannot reach because of barriers like this, which is, it's really too bad because the areas are there, they're just not accessible.
Tonight is the night, and we plan to catch a lot of glass eels. There will be many volunteers and many nets, and we will put them all at once at this place. It doesn't look promising right now, but the water will go up because it's tight, and we will catch them and tag them with different colors.
These are substrates, devices where eels can hide safely when we will release them back after tagging. Normally, eels are resting during a day and migrating at night. That's why we're doing tagging so late, because during the day they're chilling. Glass eels are attracted by the fresh water. The more fresh water being released into the sea, the more chances that the eels will come here. And looks like Netherlands pumping really a lot, because eels are ready to travel 6,000 kilometers to end up in this muddy place.
Here we can take some waders and join the guys in the mud bath. I already hate it. why even I'm here and doing all this? Oh, it's cold and now we're gonna go in this mud.
Pumping stations and locations are very different, right? Some of them we find a high effectiveness that will be around 60 to 70% of fish passing through. But some of them we find that only 5%. And some of them might be more effective in one place than in another place as well. So that's why it's very specialized and very local research.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Perfect. That's it, yeah?
Yes, in the first one.
In the first one.
The front one.
Okay. I'm stuck. That's insane. I barely can walk here. The mud is so deep. Yeah. I'm here. Okay, Eels. Here we go. I try to be fast, but...
That's crazy. I don't know how to explain. It's like impossible to walk completely. Look at my
shoe.
and my legs, they're stuck all the time, and I need to move from one net to another. And I've got this thingy, and I need to bring heels into the different buckets, and it's hard. I have to be fast, because, you know, they cannot breathe air. But man, it's hard.
This foam is from a water treatment plant, which makes everything much harder. We also catch different type of fish, so we have to put each species in a different bucket.
Very good. You're a good fisherman.
Or a lucky one.
This mud is crazy. Yeah.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah.
Good job.
You guys are really badass doing this job. It's like such intense. Why are you doing this?
A few years ago I heard an ad on the radio. They were looking for people to fish for the glass eels. So I thought, why not? And I'm now for the fourth year.
Do you like this kind of job?
Well, it's nice. This a little muddy over here. A little mud.
You like mud?
No, I'm happy. I'm not. I have to be here two times a week. It's for the good cause, eh?
Exactly.
For the good cause.
Exactly. So now we've got more than 200 of glass eels. That's the minimum amount we need to start tagging them. And it's actually very interesting because it will be in different colors. So let's go.
It's very noisy here inside because of the oxygen pumps. So at first we need to prepare everything for the tagging, the needles, colors, and a bunch of other things.
No way, you can stop and you put a little bit of the fluid, but also a little bit of this, and it's some hardener, so it hardens out in the fish, so it's not long in the river anymore.
We're also tagging fish, so we start with it because it's easier and we have much less of them. The procedure is very simple. We just inject color at the very tip of the tail.
You can see how it's lighting up under the UV light.
With fish it's easy, but for eels we have a bit more complex procedure. Because first of all we need to use anesthesia. We pour it in this container, then add eels and wait a little bit. At first they're very active, then become slower and slower, until completely freeze and become straight like a sticks. Now we can inject colors and then wait for them to wake up, which should take about 20-30 minutes. In total, we catched more than 600 glass eels this night. We use different colors for different days and locations. And later, when we will release them back into the sea, by these color codes we will be able to see how long does it takes for eels to get into the passageway and through it. And with this data, it will be possible to improve or change passageways to make them more effective and suitable for the eels and other migrating fish.
It's incredibly important to save nature in general. And I think eels are an amazing species. As you said, it's such a mystery why they have this giant migration route and they come back and they've been existing for so many years, and then that would all be cut short because we put all these barriers here when there's so much we can do to prevent that.
Now it's 4 a.m. and we just finished, not really finished till the end, but it's crazy. These guys, I don't get it. They're like so badass. They work for free in such conditions. It's so wet, so cold. It's slippery, you're all in the mud, and it's at night. I don't know, if you're keen for such activities, they always need volunteers. So the links will be under this video. And if you like what we are doing, subscribe to our channel, support us on Patreon, and be brave to act.